was younger, so much younger than today. Never needed anybody help in any way. But now those days are gone, and I'm not so self-assured. Now I know I need you like I've never done before. Help me if you can, I'm feeling down. And I do appreciate you being around. Help me get my feet back on the ground. Won't you please, please help me? Now my life has changed in oh so many ways. My independence has vanished in a haze. But every now and then I still feel a little insecure. And I know I need him like I've never. Won't you please, please help me? Anybody need some help here this morning from Jesus? Why don't we just give him a big clap and a big praise right now while we pray? When I was younger, so much younger than today, never needed anybody to help in any way. But now those days are gone, and I'm not so self-assured. Now I know I need him like I've never done before. Help me if you can. Let's lift up the name of Jesus. Give him praise one more time. Somebody shout hallelujah. I like it here in Amos Montemorfof. It's great to see you. I can't wait to hear myself preach. How many have come here this morning and say, Ray, when you sang that song, that's where I am right here. I've come here not to socialize. I've come here, you know, not to be seen. But I really have come here this morning to receive some help from Jesus. Am I talking to the right people here? Just more fallback on the vocal here. Thank you. Well, you're in the right place. I'm from Wales. My name is Ray Bevan. I'm from Wales. Jonah came from Wales. What a rubbish joke that was. But you laughed just to humor me. Thank you so much indeed. Some strange things happen in churches in Wales. I heard a story. Now, I don't know if this is true, but I heard it, right? So this preacher was preaching in a church in Wales, and as he was preaching, the devil appeared behind him in the pulpit. So the congregation saw the devil. They all screamed and ran out of the building. So the pastor didn't know what was going on. So he turns around. He sees the devil. He screams. He runs out. Except for George Thomas, elder in the church, 40 years, sitting on the front row, unmoved. So the devil leans forward and he says, "Aren't you afraid of me?" George says, "Nah, not really." "Don't you know who I am?" Yeah. The tail, the horns, bit of a giveaway. "Then why aren't you afraid of me?" "Well, I've been married to your sister for 40 years. I don't know if it's true or not, but weird things happen." There's a man looking at his wife up there in a very strange way. No, it's not true. Okay. But I just yesterday we had a great time with the leaders of the church here. And can I just say, you know, I have the privilege of traveling the world, ministering all over the world. But there's something about my connection with Redemption Church, South Africa and here, and who knows, in other nations in Europe. I believe this is only the beginning. Somebody say amen. I believe that's why sometimes you face different stuff, because the enemy hates what's happening here. Because I believe I'm looking at a bunch of born again, faith-filled, demon crushing believers in this house. Come on, am I talking? yesterday we had a great time, and this morning I just feel there are people struggling in a certain area of their life. I think I shared this before, but under the old covenant, when God's people would come into his house to worship, God said, if you come into my presence from the west gate, you have to leave through the east gate. If you come into my presence from the north gate, you have to leave through the south gate. The lesson, you don't leave God's presence the same way that you come into God's presence. And if that's the case under the old covenant, how much more under the new covenant? Let's believe if you came in here sick, you're going to walk out healed in the name of Jesus. Let's believe if you came in here confused, you're going to walk out of here with the wisdom of God that will change your life. And if you came in here with a broken heart, you can't medicate away a broken heart. But there is one, we stand in his presence, who says, I am anointed to heal the brokenhearted. I believe miracles are going to take place in this place this morning. Can I hear an amen if I'm in the presence of believers in the house right here? Listen to the scripture. Let me just read the scripture to you, and then we'll go from there. The scripture is 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 15. It's going to come up on the screen. But even to this day, when Moses is read, in other words, when the law is read, a veil lies on their heart. In other words, we really can't understand this. Watch. Next verse. Oh, that is it. Okay. But watch this. But I should have put 16 as well. But when one turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now the Lord is spirit, and where the spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Come on, somebody, say amen. Where the spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And then I ask the question, in this context, Lord, freedom from what? And this message came out of that question, and this answer came back to me. Freedom from schizophrenic Christianity. I've never heard that phrase before, so I believe I've had it from the Holy Ghost, okay? Freedom from schizophrenic Christianity. What does that mean? It means a Christian living under two covenants. And when I read this, I began to realize there's a disease that's running rampant across the church, robbing believers of enjoying the revelation of a grace-filled life. And the only antidote to schizophrenic Christianity is to have a real revelation of the new covenant. You know, I love golf. I'm an avid golfer. I've been playing for like 40 years. But there was a time when I nearly gave up the game because I was down the driving range practicing my golf swing and nothing was working. The balls were going everywhere and I decided I'm giving up this game. It's too frustrating. And as I was putting my clubs in the bag to go home, the professional was watching me from the window. And he said, "What's your problem, bro?" I said, "Golf is the problem." I said, "I'm going home. I'm never playing this game again." He said, "But I've been watching you from the window." He said, "If I give you a few simple truths about your swing, could you give me 5 minutes?" 5 minutes later, this guy just gave me some instruction, some truth about what I was doing wrong. And I went from depression to elation in about 5 minutes. Why? Because truth set me free. Now, he didn't say to me, "Oh, listen, if you want to improve your game, then just go into this room here, and there's videos of great golfers. Just sit there and watch them. There's trophies there that they've won. Just touch the trophies, feel the atmosphere, and get inspired by looking at these pictures." Now, I would be inspired, I'd be moved, I'd be touched, but I would still be ignorant on how to correct my swing. I would come out of that room feeling great, watch, but still playing bad. I'd come out incredibly inspired, but still frustrated. Why? Because I needed truth to set me free, not some emotional high or some inspirational atmosphere. Come on, somebody, say amen right here. And I lived like this for years. For years, I lived on that feeling, touchy, inspirational. And I was still defeated by sin, still living with condemnation, still overwhelmed by circumstance, still tricked by Satan, still frustrated with my humanity. And I would go to all the meetings. My God, was I inspired. The music was great. The atmosphere was fantastic. And I come out of the meeting feeling great for a while. And then I'd fall back into my spiritual rut. The reason? I was ignorant of the truth of the new covenant. Watch. It was the knowing of that truth that would set me free. And this morning, oh, I say this with absolute confidence. There is a revelation that's going to hit your heart that will set you free for the rest of your life. Somebody say amen in this house right here. I was living schizophrenic Christianity. I was living under two covenants, married to Jesus, but flirting with Moses, dead to the law, but still alive to its demands. A schizophrenic Christianity is simple, simply explained like this. It's somebody who tries to enjoy new covenant life using old covenant obedience. And during, the COVID crisis, my God, I was in lockdown in Durban, South Africa for 2.5 months in a 5-bedroom house overlooking the Indian Ocean. Oh, it sucked, really. I had people praying for me all over the world, watching the dolphins, enjoying 30 degrees in the sun. It was awful. But anyway, I got through it, ladies and gentlemen. I really did. I got to thank you. I got through it. And then I'd be online and looking at stuff. And then the COVID hit, and now the preachers come out with 2 Chronicles 7, verse 14. If my people who are called, you've got to put the quiver because it sounds more holy, called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then God will heal you and forgive you. And I, do you know what? I got so angry. Here's a classic example of using an old covenant prayer expecting new covenant results. All because people had, these preachers had no revelation of the blessed truth of the new covenant. If my, do you know, I you know, see, repentance under the old covenant was motivated by the fear of judgment and the fear of consequence. If you don't, I will. Old covenant, watch. In the new covenant, repentance is a response to God's grace. Lord, I'm going to change because of what you have done for me. Come on, somebody. Say amen. Yeah, give the Lord a big hand clap. I'm preaching myself very happy. I'm going to listen to myself after, if this was recorded, I get saved again. I love it. It's fantastic. Watch this. Living under two covenants, it's like going down to the ATM with a discontinued card. Ever done that? I've done it once. I go down, I didn't realize, out of date. I should have read it. Put the thing in, punched in the money, nothing. Not only that, it kept the card. Now I'm shouting at the machine. I'm speaking in tongues, everything. Nothing. Come on, this is wrong. No, you're dope. The card is discontinued. You don't get the blessing with a discontinued card. Come on, somebody. The Bible says that the old covenant has been discontinued. You cannot access new covenant blessing using old covenant obedience. Do I have some believers in the house right here? Hebrews chapter 8, verse 13. Hebrews chapter 8, verse 13. When God speaks of a new covenant, why don't people get this? He has made the first obsolete. I checked out what the Hebrew word for obsolete was. Wahmwahwa. Oh, hey. Don't be moved by this. There's a lot up here. I remember when I went to Pastor Joseph's, I had the privilege of preaching for Pastor Joseph on a number of times. And the first time I went there, he introduced me. I got up, I said, well, ladies and gentlemen, the reason why Pastor Prince has asked me to come and minister to you today is because he cannot take you on a deeper level in an area of grace, so I'm here to do that. I said, he can tell you all about the garments of the high priest. I can tell you their names, their family names, and how many children they have. That's how deep. Do you know what they will? Anyway, so, no, obsolete is what? Obsolete. Put the scripture back up. There we go. Obsolete. Now, what is becoming obsolete and growing old is ready to vanish away. And then it says, that's exactly what he says. Do you know, I was preaching to the leaders yesterday. I must have lost my track of thought about 5 times. So if I do that, please tell me where I am. No, not in Amersfoort. Tell me where I am in my preaching, okay? Here we go. Can I hear a big amen right here? Watch this. Under the new covenant, if my people, watch, under the new covenant, the if is removed. Under the grace covenant, get this for a whammo. Under the grace covenant, human reliability is removed. It doesn't depend upon your faithfulness. It doesn't depend upon your perseverance. It all depends upon His faithfulness and what He has done for us. You don't need to make a New Year's resolution. You need a new covenant revelation. Come on, that's a good one. That's tweetable right there. I'll say it again because you want me to say it again. I will. You don't need a New Year's resolution. Do you know, 80% of New Year's resolutions are broken by 15 days into January. That's your faithfulness. I'm not going to put my faith in my faithfulness. I'm going to put my faith in His faithfulness to keep His promise. Your resolution is dependent upon your faithfulness to keep that promise. A revelation of the new covenant is a declaration that God always keeps His. Come on, man. That's sure ground to stand on. You see, schizophrenic Christianity speaks like this. Well, when you sin as a Christian, your fellowship with God is broken. And the only way to restore it is through your repentance. Well, I'd like to know how, when I've repented enough. So is it 3 hours, 4 hours? Is that with snot or without snot? What is the deal here? Come on, somebody, say amen. We evaluate, break it up. No, man, it's not about that. Did I just say that, Paul? I did, okay, I just said it. People are saying, did he say? I did, listen. Yeah, here's another one. You cannot take communion until you make yourself right with God. Here's another one. The blessings of the new covenant is dependent upon your obedience and your faithfulness. Now listen, the key to your freedom from schizophrenic Christianity is not contrition. It's context. It's not repentance. It's revelation. It's knowing the truth. I'm taking you somewhere on a journey, okay? I'm going to hit something specific this morning that's going to set you free. It's going to take me maybe about 4 hours to get there, but there's nothing on the TV, okay? No, I'm joking, everybody. Somebody went so depressed then. No, I'm just teasing you, okay? Because I know the Dutch people, they take things as it is. I'm joking, okay? It's vital to understand that the new covenant did not start until after the cross and the resurrection. It's so important. Why is that important? Because much of what Jesus said in the Gospels doesn't apply to Christians. But Jesus said it. It's in red. No, I know that. But I believe that. I believe. Okay, if that's the case, what about this then? Jesus said this, okay? When he was talking to people about dealing with sin, particularly lust, okay? This is what he said. If your right eye offends you, gouge it out. Well, Jesus said it. Well, if that's the answer to overcome lust, if that relates to New Covenant believers, then every hot-blooded male in this room should be blind by now. That was a joke. I'll say it again because you didn't get it. If that is true, if we should obey the words of Jesus, then every hot-blooded male in this room should be blind by now. Thank you. People are still trying to get this. You see, some of you guys only have to see a bare ankle and you've lost two eyes. Come on, I'm talking the truth here, you can take it. But you see, religious tradition has insisted that we live under two covenants. And here it is, using this schizo teaching, it's held many believers bound to guilt and shame, particularly in the area of conditional forgiveness. If you're still with me, say amen. Watch this. And how many of you know that the devil is brilliant at taking scripture and using it against you? He is a theologian, trust me. What did he say to Jesus in the wilderness? He was quoting scripture, throwing scripture at him. And he does the same with Christians. Only he takes the scripture out of context. And here's one now. Religious tradition uses this deception to keep God's people bound by conditional forgiveness. And the one scripture or the one area that Satan uses, and this is like treading on holy ground for some people, he actually will take the Lord's Prayer, what we traditionally know as the Lord's Prayer, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. And we pray it. And there are some great principles in the prayer as Jesus taught the disciples. But watch this, please watch this. The Lord's Prayer that we just accept because it's religious tradition, the Lord's Prayer is actually an old covenant prayer which includes conditional forgiveness. It goes down, forgive me, Father, watch, in the same way that I forgive others. And right at the end of Matthew 6, here's the condition. Jesus said it, it's in red. If you forgive those who sin against you, your heavenly Father will forgive you. But if you refuse to forgive others, your Father will not forgive you. Jesus said that. And because Christians, believers, have no revelation or contextually regarding the new covenant, they've taken that verse and they've been living in bondage for years because Jesus said it. Immediately, conditional forgiveness is brought into focus. And because this old covenant prayer, watch, a prayer the early church never prayed. Check it out. It's accepted as a new covenant prayer because Jesus prayed it. It's brought so many believers into bondage. Listen to what I'm about to say. In the new covenant, God never blackmails us with his forgiveness. He never holds us ransom to get us to forgive others. Without going into too much detail here, the prayer that Jesus taught the disciples, he could only teach them to a level that was under the law. He couldn't teach them to pray in his name because he hadn't been given that name yet. He hadn't died and been resurrected and ascended. So he could only teach them to the level he could teach them under the law. And that's what, in fact, on one occasion he said, you know what? You haven't asked anything in my name yet, but one day you will. There's coming a day when you can pray in my name. You can ask anything that you want and I will give it to you. Come on, somebody, say amen right here. I'm going somewhere with this because it's so important. And because religion has taken this prayer out of context, it's produced schizophrenic Christianity, living under two covenants. And you know what I've discovered as I talk to people and minister to people? There's nothing worse for a Christian to live with the fear that God's forgiveness is conditional. You can never live a contented life in God worrying about daily forgiveness. Believing that God's forgiveness lasts only until the next sin. And then based on your repentance and willpower, he forgives you again until the next sin. And I declare this to Redemption Church in the Netherlands right now. You can never preach the gospel of forgiveness effectively if you're worrying about your own. Somebody say amen here. Under the new covenant, God's forgiveness is free, undeserving, and totally unconditional. You can't sin your way out of it. You can't repent your way back into it. You can't repay it with service and faithfulness and obedience. Any attempt to do these things, to merit or maintain God's forgiveness toward you, is an insult to the finished work of Christ. If you believed the gospel and received Christ, you are graced with unconditional forgiveness from God. He will never turn it off. He will never pause it when you sin. Come on, somebody, say amen! And he will never put conditions on it. He continues to forgive you. And here's the truth you need to know that's going to set you free this morning. The forgiveness, he will never put conditions on it. And the forgiveness, and he continues to forgive you even when you're struggling to forgive others. Why? Because forgiveness from God is not something you are receiving in installments, one sin at a time. It's something you already have the moment that you got saved. Hebrews 10, verse 12, but our high priest offered himself to God as a single sacrifice for sins, good for all time. Verse 14, for by that one offering, he forever made perfect those who are being made holy. And the reason why this is so important is because religion focuses on behavior, grace focuses on blood. Come on, somebody, say amen. That's the difference between Old Covenant and New Covenant. Ephesians 1:7 says, in him we have. Not we are hoping to have or we can lose it. In him we have redemption through his blood, not behavior. The forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. If you are believing this stuff, can you give the Lord a big hand clap in the house? Because I'm preaching myself very happy, really happy right here. It's not about your behavior. It's about his blood. When the angel of death passed through the streets of Egypt, he was given one command by God. When you see a house that has blood on the doorposts and lintels, it declares to you that whoever is inside is trusting my sacrifice, not theirs. Christianity is not the sacrifice we make. It's the sacrifice we trust. Can you imagine the angel coming along and saying, now that's too easy. No, I want to go inside and check how they've been living this week before I pass over. God says, hey, listen. Listen, when you see the blood, you pass over that house. No judgment there because they put their faith in my blood. Come on, somebody. I don't put my faith in my behavior. I put my faith in his blood. And that revelation is the key to release you from unforgiveness towards others. Ephesians 4, verse 24 says this, be kind to each other, tender-hearted, watch, forgiving one another, or else I won't forgive you. Does it say that? No. Just as God through Christ has forgiven you. Come on, somebody. Watch this, I'm going to pray in just a minute. We're going to break some chains here. I said, we're going to break some chains in this house right here so that you can start to enjoy what's rightfully yours in Christ. Because I know the power to forgive others is the revelation of God's unconditional forgiveness toward you. You see, his forgiveness is based on blood, not apology. I want this to sink in. In God's economy, there's only one thing that brings forgiveness and reconciliation, and that's the power of his blood, not the passion of your confession. Come on, somebody say amen. And when I was praying about this morning, I want to say this as I bring this to a close and begin to pray. There are some of you here. The reason why I've said all that is to say this. There are some of you here in turmoil. And you know why? Because you're desperately trying to deal with unforgiveness in your heart towards somebody. And I'm not minimizing the abuse. I'm not minimizing the trauma. What was done to some of you is atrocious. And you're a believer. And people say, well, you got to forgive. Yeah, it's not that easy, is it? And then on top of that, you live with the fear, because I'm struggling to forgive, God's not forgiving me. So you're living in this schizophrenic covenant lifestyle, because you've been told, and Jesus said it, if you don't forgive, I'm not going to forgive you. And you are here struggling with all this stuff, devastated by the realization that you're in a state that God is withholding forgiveness from you. I want to declare to you in the name of Jesus, if you've been told that God will not forgive you until you forgive others, I want to declare to you, based on the revelation of the new covenant, that is a lie. You are always forgiven in the eyes of your Father, based on his blood, not your behavior. And you have to receive that if you are going to have help and strength to forgive others. You know, people are going to forgive people this morning. Some of you are going to let people go. Not because I've got to in order to get God's forgiveness. No. Wow, Ray, never realized that God forgives me even though I'm struggling to forgive others. Oh, yeah, because that is going to be the power that's going to help you. We're going to let them go in a moment. Watch this. I'm going to finish with this. Do you know, that's the reason why, you see, the reason why there's a lack of horizontal forgiveness in the church is because we don't understand vertical forgiveness. And when God told Moses to create the Ark of the Covenant, a box overlaid with gold, and he said, in the box, I want you to put the Ten Commandments. I want you to put the law. I want you to put my standard. I want you to put perfection. Because if I speak to you from that, I'll have to kill you. Because nobody, I demand perfection. And nobody can do that. So put it in the box, out of my sight, and then make a mercy seat out of pure gold and make it slightly bigger than the box, because mercy is always bigger than judgment. And then sacrifice an animal. Blood has to be shed for the sin. Take the blood and you sprinkle it on the mercy seat, and my righteousness is satisfied. And Moses, I can speak to you from there. If I speak to you from here, I'm going to have to kill you. But I've made a way so I can speak to you from here. It's called mercy. I'm not going to give you what you deserve. Watch. And he said, out of the same piece of gold, I want you to make cherubims. That's coming up. I saw a picture of it in Rotterdam yesterday. Cherubims coming up out of the side, and their wings are to be stretched over the mercy seat, and they are to be facing each other. But Moses, make sure they're not looking at each other. Make sure when you form them, make sure they're facing each other, but they're looking down. Because when they look down, if they looked at each other, they would just see a replica of themselves. But when they're looking down, they'll see each other through the reflection of the blood of my mercy. Come on, somebody. I want you to get this. I want you to get this. And the reason why we struggle with horizontal forgiveness in the church is because we're facing each other. Well, when you look at somebody's faults, hey, listen, you're looking at somebody looking back at you thinking the same thing. But when we look at each other through the blood of the new covenant, I'm telling you, when we get this right, this will be right. Can I hear an amen here? Okay, those of you . This is not a football match where one side has to win. This is the church of the living God where we all win. Amen. You're not in competition with me and me with you. The only perfect one in this room is standing up here right now preaching. You are the rest of you rubbish. Yeah, what a joke that is. So why do we live like this? Who cares? There's a nation that needs Jesus here. Holland needs a revelation of Jesus. And this is how they're going to see him in one way. Jesus says, this is how they're going to know my love, when they see how you love each other. So for those of you right now, I'm going to pray two prayers this morning. One, I'm going to pray for people who are struggling to forgive someone. And the reason you're going to receive help is because you know this is unchanged. But God wants to help you with this. And then I'm going to pray a prayer for people who want to receive forgiveness for all their sins and start to live in the new covenant with Jesus in their life. I want every head to be bowed and every eye to be shut right now. Holy Spirit, watch over your word to perform it right now. I pray for those who are struggling with unforgiveness. They've been hurt, they've been abused. And they really are. They want to forgive, but they find it hard. Lord, you're going to help them. This morning, you are going to help them. And we're going to deal with this once and for all. If that is you, if you fall in that category, very quickly, raise your hand. Don't be afraid. Come on, raise it up. Raise it up. Say, Ray, I need help. Keep it up. Keep your hand up. Keep your hand up, because we got to do something. This is going to go once and for all. Okay, put your hands down. Could everybody in the building please stand up and just face me right now? Have you received the word of God this morning? Let's do this. Let's do this once and for all, okay? They say, oh, the Dutch people are very reserved. No, I've seen you in a football match. Don't give me that rubbish. I've seen you women shopping in the sales. You'll kill to get that dress. So, do you know, whenever Jesus asked people to follow him, it was always in public. Trust me. I'm a pastor for 25 years, and this is so important to you, okay? I want to pray for those who are struggling to forgive, and I want to help you deal with that this morning. Truly, it works. And I'm going to ask you, if you want to bring a friend with you, that's fine. I'm going to ask you to come and stand with me here. Could you do that now? Leave your seat and come and stand with me here. Come. Those that put their hand up, come and stand with me right here. Come. Yeah. It takes guts. It takes courage. Guts, I know. And you're thinking, oh, what will people think? Who cares what people think? This is between you and God. Do you know, wherever I go and preach this message, sometimes over a third of the church comes forward. Because it's a major issue. Come on. If you're a little bit Hetterson, turn to a friend and say, please, will you come with me? I need to deal with this now. I'll wait for you. Yeah, come, people are coming. I'll wait for you. And some of the stuff that some of you have gone through, and people have come and say, oh, you got to forgive. It's not that easy, is it? But God's going to help you right now. Just keyboard right now, guys. Thank you. Is there anybody else? Please, I'll wait for you, because your heart is beating a little faster than, oh. But you came for help. God wants to help you. Yes. People are still coming. This is awesome. Because we're going to do something. I'm going to do something to help you. I do this everywhere I go. I preached a message in Budapest, like similar to this. The response was the same. Is there one more? Is there one more? They'll say, Ray, please don't pray until I come. Yes, come. 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 We'll wait. We'll wait. You're that important to Jesus. Those of you in the front, just look at me right now. God bless you for your courage. And you know what? Just the fact that you're standing here tells God that you mean business with this. He has seen your struggle. He has seen your struggle. And he has seen the way that you've condemned yourself. You hate yourself because you can't forgive. He's seen that. That's why he sent me this morning. That's why he sent me this morning, to help you. So this is what we're going to do. You know, sometimes when Jesus wanted to do something supernatural, he did something natural. Like, for instance, when he wanted to heal a blind man, he made some mud. He could have just laid hands on him, but he made some mud. He was by doing that, he was instilling faith into the blind man. He's going to do something with my eyes. Sometimes he put a finger in somebody's ear. Sometimes, well, on one occasion, he spat at someone. I'm not going to do that this morning, okay? Don't worry. But this is what we're going to do. I want you to put your right hand out like this. Forget everybody else in the building. It's you and Jesus. I want you to look at your right hand. And everything we do is by faith. Everything. So I want you to put in your hand all the people you're struggling to forgive, okay? Because we're going to just give them to Jesus now. We're going to give them. I know they hurt you. I know it was bad. I know they deserve judgment and all that stuff, but that's up to God, okay? We're going to give it to God. Yeah, put him in too. Yeah, put her in as well. And also, put you in there. That hatred you have for yourself, put that in there too. Okay, close your fist around that stuff. And we're going to give it to God. Okay, raise up your hand. Let it go. Raise your other hand and start to thank Jesus. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Come on, church, help them. Stretch your hands towards these people and be, come on, let it go, let it go. Okay. Jesus, you're the center of it all. Come on, come on, come on, thank him, thank him. Keep thanking him, keep thanking him, keep thanking him. Sing the song, whoever's singing, sing. Come on, give him thanks, give him thanks, give him thanks, give him thanks. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you right now. We break the chains, that have held these people bound, and we let them go. In Jesus' name. Sing it. Come on, church, raise your hands to heaven. Rusa sa preta. Lord, let a spirit of forgiveness flow through this house. Flow through this house. And those watching online, let the spirit of forgiveness flow through this house. Receive, 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 receive. Receive, receive. Father, in Jesus' name, I speak peace. I speak joy. I speak healing into the lives of these people right now in Jesus' name.
And still, with every head bowed and every eye shut, here's the second prayer. If you are here, you say, Ray, you know what? I never knew that my sins were forgiven. I want to receive forgiveness for my sins, and I want Jesus to come into my life. If that's you, I'm going to count to three, and I want you to raise your hand. I'm not going to call you out, but I want you to raise your hand where you are. If you want to pray a prayer like this, Jesus, I receive forgiveness and invite you into my heart. I believe that you died for me on the cross for my sin, and I receive you. If you want to pray a prayer like that, when I count to three, raise your hand. Here we go. One, two, three. Raise it up high. Keep it high so I can see. Yes, 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 yes. Hands going up everywhere. Yes, 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 yes. Father, you see these hands raised? And there are some that are still raising their hands right now. The power of God is in this place. I thank you right now. A miracle is taking place in their lives. They will never be the same again. An angel is taking a pen, dipping it in the blood of Jesus, and writing their names in the Lamb's Book of Life. And no demon or person can eradicate that name ever, ever again. Father, I commend them to the safekeeping of your grace. And for those that have just released those people from their lives, I thank you. Their lives will never be the same again. Hey guys, go in peace. Go in peace. Go in peace. Let's give the Lord a big clap. Thank you very much. God bless you, everybody. Come on, give the Lord one more. Can I just say this? Thank you so much. You know, I just love this house. And my new book is out called Graced. And I could only cover a small area this morning. But there's a lot of stuff in here. It's nice, and you can read this in a couple of hours. I've only got 16 books left. We sold a load yesterday, and they'll be for sale out there. Also, if you want to check my website out, there's lots of stuff on there. Paul, thank you for hosting me, and thank you guys for making my stay so wonderful in Amersfoort, and I hope to see you again sometime. God bless you, everybody.